Graniola. This is the Graniola channel, and I'd like to tell you a folk tale.
Well, it may be honestly difficult to get anyone just by telling them to do so to be more generous or well-behaved. If you weave those concepts into a story, you might be able to change their behavior.
This story called One Single Lemon tries to make the listener understand why it's good to be truthful. One morning in the very distant past, it could have been 300 years ago, or it might have been 400, an old king requested that his son come and sit next to him at his bedside. He understood that he was dying and that in a few days his son would have to take over control of their kingdom. Although he had been a good king, his country had gone through many years of natural disasters with fires and floods and droughts. This meant that many of his subjects were in dire straits, poor and suffering. In order to help them, he made his son promise to open the palace gates and to reach out to the people, offering them work so that they could make a living. Together, the two of them wrote out notices to be sent out around the countryside, inviting their subjects to come to the castle and interview for work. The father was at peace when he died, and the son was happy when he saw that people started to come to him for help. News of the young king's offer spread rapidly, and the wife of a poor farmer heard about it in the marketplace. She was excited when she told her husband the news, but he was despondent when he thought that he could not go to an audience with the king without taking a gift, and they were too poor for him to get one. His wife tried to cheer him up. "You're absolutely right. We have very little, but we have this one coin left, and I have a good feeling. Please, take it with you now, for I'm certain you'll find something perfect to buy on your way to the castle." The man left with the coin and began the 2-hour walk ahead of him. On his way, he met a woman selling lemons, and the price of one was exactly the value of his coin. He bought the lemon and put it in his pocket. When he reached the palace, the guards asked him what business he had there, and he told them that he had come to apply for a job with a young king. They said that if they allowed him to enter, he would have to give them half of what the king offered to him. The man agreed because he felt that if the king was generous with him, he would happily share his good luck with others, and without a doubt, half was better than nothing. Once he was in front of the king, he bowed his head and expressed his gratitude, and he brought the lemon out of his pocket to offer as a gift of thanks. The king brought the lemon up to his face and was delighted by its wonderful scent. It was clear to him from the way he was dressed that the man in front of him must be very poor, and the king understood that making even this humble gift must have been a big sacrifice for him. The young ruler was a very good judge of character, and he realized that the other must be a very conscientious person because it would have been difficult for him just to get there. Without hesitating, he graciously invited the man to have lunch with himself, his wife, his sons, and his ministers. The others were already seated at the enormous table when the two men entered the elegant dining room. At one end of the table, there was an ornately carved silver tray piled high with rice and a gigantic turkey. Before he could be seated, the king asked the man to come to the head of the table to carve and then serve the meal. The man's immediate reaction was that he was too humble to perform such a task, and he was just on the point of politely demurring when he reminded himself that he was there to do the king's bidding, and he picked up the carving knife. He then quietly and efficiently divided and plated the food. When all of the plates had been served, the king asked him how he determined who should get which portion. "Well, as you saw, sir, the first thing I did was to separate the head, and I gave it to you. With your great knowledge, you rule our country, and you are our king and our head. Next, I gave one wing to each of your two small sons, because your heart makes a flight of happiness each time you see them or think about them, just as your father's did when he saw or thought about you. And as they grow, they will fly out into this land and spread happiness here, just as you're doing now. I gave the thighs to your ministers, who must move around the country and share your ideas. The breast I left in front of the empty chair where you've saved a place for me, because this piece contains the heart, where I, just like all of your other subjects, hold our love for you. The last piece, which is the back, I gave to the queen, because she is always behind you and always supports you." The king was well satisfied with all that the man had said and realized that he was a person who was not only good-mannered and generous, but also extremely clever. And as such, he offered him a job as a counselor, which came with a huge salary and a cart full of riches to take back to his wife. The guards were quick to remind him of his promise to share half with them, and because he was so grateful for his own good fortune, he was happy to do so. As you might imagine, his neighbors were fascinated, and when they asked what had happened and his wife explained, the couple next door put together their own plan. The man was a merchant, and he was not at all as poor as the farmer. He put on his best suit of clothes so that he would look important when he met with the king. He loaded several kilos of lemon into saddlebags on top of his donkey and set off for an interview. When the palace guard requested half of what would be his reward, he gladly agreed, but in his mind, he imagined that he would never honor his promise. The king seemed more puzzled than grateful when he presented the two big bags of lemon, but he was indeed invited to lunch, just as his neighbor had been, and ordered to carve and serve the food. But this time the king interrupted before he had finished the task. With a little bit of irritation, he asked, "Why did you serve the head to yourself and give the big breast to me?" "Well, you are a great king, so you deserve the choice piece of the turkey. And I, being a humble subject, took for myself the least desirable piece." The king was furious. "Ah, you are an absolute fool. I understand now why you brought the huge bag of lemons. You were copying what happened yesterday. I am a king. I do not need you to give me the biggest piece of turkey. I am spending my time trying to help people, good souls who are in need of my assistance, not people trying to twist a situation to their advantage. Leave this place immediately and don't waste any more of my time." The merchant returned to his home, and the great king continued to help his people whenever he could and was well loved by all, as was his counselor. This story comes from a country that's sadly been in the news quite a bit recently. This is a tale that is told in Syria.